items, and the first two I'm going to ask the board to consider adding, or I will ask for actual action to take it on when you get to that agenda item. The third one will just be for discussion, but it's time-sensitive discussion. Mr. Chairman, I hope you see at your station a resolution of the Forsyth County Board of Commissioners authorizing the transfer of funds related to PMAMC, which is going to be the county's self-insured workers' compensation administrator. Mr. Chairman, I would request that this resolution be added on a time-sensitive basis to the end of the new business agenda.
Item two, Counselor?
Yes, sir.
Time-sensitive, you said?
Yes, sir.
So moved.
Second. I have a motion to second add item number two as a time-sensitive resolution. Continue. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0, Counselor.
Mr. Chairman, the next item I would add is this would be item three, would be a resolution authorizing the appointment of conflict counsel. Mr. Chairman, the Forsyth County and the county sheriff may have another issue involving a potential threat of litigation. And Mr. Chairman, I need to ensure that I, first of all, am not able to represent the county in that, and request the board authorize me to select conflict counsel. And that would be another resolution.
Amen.
Does
that need to be time sensitive, Counselor?
It will be time sensitive to get on the agenda, yes, sir.
Okay. Have a motion to second to add item three. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0.
Mr. Chairman, the last item I would ask be added as a time sensitive item for placement on the agenda is an agreement for reserve sewer capacity settlement, release, payment of compromise amount, and others in between Forsyth County and State Bank. I would simply ask that be added to the agenda this evening, Mr. Chairman, so I may go over it with the board. I will not ask for you to approve it or take any action, but I won't be here Tuesday at the work session, and I'm afraid a replacement lawyer won't know these facts well enough.
New business number four?
Yes, sir.
Second. Motion second. Add new business number four, sewer capacity settlement. Please vote. That motion carries 5-0.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Counselor. Any other items? Do I hear a motion to adopt the agenda as amended?
So moved.
Second.
Motion second. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Announcements and reports. I have a little lengthy announcement tonight I want to make. Read through it. It's just a special announcement this evening. It involves the two recent weather events we have experienced. I reckon we all remember Snow Jam 1 and 2. So, while these weather events certainly disrupted our lives and impacted us all, I think we can breathe overall Forsyth County fared quite well. And it is no doubt due in large part to the amazing county staff. Doug wrote that, not me. Personnel from a number of county departments and agencies responded to these weather events and provided our community with outstanding services. Now, this was most certainly a team effort. I would like to recognize those departments and agencies who played a large role in our response. If the following people would stand up and at the end of this, we're going to try to make a photo op, please. First of all, our Emergency Management Agency Director, Mr. Danny Bowman, and Deputy Director Chris Grimes. Is he here tonight?
Thank you, sir.
Thank you for your leadership throughout these events. Thank y'all. Appreciate it. How many hours did you stay up, Chief?
Thank you.
How many hours did you stay up?
I'm so sorry, Mr. Chairman.
How many hours did you stay up in that event?
21.
21 hours.
That was the best I recall.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Sheriff Wayne Piper, are you here with your staff, sir? He's in the back, Sheriff Piper. If the others could stand up, please. Come on, guys. Sheriff Wayne Piper. No, Sheriff, thank you, sir. Sheriff's office, command staff, and all his personnel, we thank you for being there to assist our citizens, going way beyond your efforts and all. We really thank you for being out in this time of snow event. Thank you all. Thank you. Recognize Fire Chief Danny Bowman again, and his fire department command staff and all personnel. Thank you for breaking the elements to aid our residents who were in need. Thank you, sir. Center Director Pat Giordano, can you stand up? Or should we staff if they're here? who works so diligently. 911 Center Pat Giardano and her entire staff, we appreciate the long hours spent answering 911 calls and ensuring our citizens receiving the assistance they needed. Thank you. Whether the power outage, it went very well. They got the power back on and everything worked well, so we did good.
Thank you.
Engineering Department, John Kennard, are you here? I can't see you, best I'm sorry. Road Superintendent Rick Tittle?
I'm representing the Bridges.
And the entire Roads and Bridges Division. You're all in the front line, street and plowing our roads and making the roads safe as possible for all our first responders. We really thank you. And all your staff, thank you. Fleet Services Director Avery Gravitt and his staff. Avery, your work in keeping the county vehicles and equipment running smoothly during the inclement weather was critical. His job was putting chains on everything that came into his office, so he did a great job on it. I mean, chains you put on and took off, maybe, but we appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. The public facilities, parks and recreation, water, sewer departments. I guess, Tim, got anybody here with you? You represent the whole?
There I am.
Good. You did a great job in monitoring conditions, treating the entrances and parking areas at many county buildings. Thank you, Tim. County Manager Doug Deere and Deputy County Manager Tim Mayer. Doug, you can stand up. And Tim. Thank you for your leadership and our county staff throughout these weather events. And I will tell you, I enjoyed the calls at 4 o'clock in the morning. It was appreciated. And our roads were before I went to bed at night. So thank you. You did a great job.
You're welcome. Thank you.
I would also like to recognize the outstanding team effort and cooperation that took place during these events. In addition to coordination among county agencies and departments, there was open dialogue and cooperation with the City of Cumming, the Board of Education, the National Guard, the Red Cross, Northside Hospital, Georgia Power, and many others. It is a true reflection on how well our community works during challenging times. On behalf of the Board of Commissioners, I would like to say thank you to all and each and every one of the staff members who played a role in the county's response to these weather events. You did a fantastic job, all of you. And I want to know, tell you how much we appreciate it. Thank you very much for you doing. Work good. Thank you. The hands want to come down head of departments and bring a few others. We have a photo op, please.
Chairman, while they're doing that, I just wanted to mention, I don't know that you mentioned the GIS department procurement. Is anyone here from GIS procurement? I know John Kilgore is here.
Yes.
John, please stand. And anybody else we might have missed, this is a team effort. All the county departments that were involved, we appreciate it. And they are also their support staff. If it wasn't for them, we would not have been able to get through the storm the way we got through it. So thank you for everybody, and I appreciate it. If we missed anybody, please stand and please be recognized. Thank you.
Please come forward. We have a picture, please.
Wide enough.
Sorry.
I'm sorry.
Okay, ready?
Yeah.
Yep.
Cheese.
Cheese.
One more.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Tuesday night at the Forsyth Conference Center, we're going to be having our second drug summit. It's a very informative event with our sheriff's office, our board of education, our judicial system, and our county government, trying to make people more aware of the drugs that are in our community, see the signs, heed the warnings, to know what your kids might be. They might be getting educated more than you are. And we're trying to make a difference in that way. So next Tuesday night at 7 p.m. at the Forsyth Conference Center, and we've got some really good speakers going to be there to help give you information. Thank you.
Any other comments?
Thank you.
At this time, Logan, we're going to the rules of the meeting and announce the public comment speakers.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. We would like to take a moment to review the meeting procedures. Please silence all cell phones and electronic devices. Please refrain from disrupting the meeting through general outbursts, applause, or comments. All comments shall be directed to the entire board and not to a particular commissioner. If you have documents for the commissioners, please provide those to the clerk. If fewer than 7 copies are submitted, only 1 copy will be retained by the clerk as part of the permanent record. Those who wish to speak must sign up by completing a public comment form available just outside this room. Information regarding specific requirements to address the board is listed at the podium. Please state that information prior to speaking. Per the county's broadcast policy, the county is not responsible for statements made during public meetings and does not warrant the accuracy of such statements. The public comments portion of the meeting is intended to allow speakers to make a verbal presentation to the board. The number of speakers is limited to 10. Speakers are selected on a first-come basis and will be heard in the order in which they signed up, with the exception that Forsyth County residents will be heard first, with non-county residents to follow until the allotted time has expired. Each speaker is limited to 3 minutes. The public comments portion is limited to 30 minutes. We have 11 public comment speakers this evening, Mr. Chairman. 11 are county residents, and it's up to board discretion how they'd like to handle that.
We'll start about a total of 30 minutes. We'll see how it
goes. Yes, sir.
Logan, start off, please.
Our first speaker is Ron Eastman.
Well, I appreciate you guys giving me some time this evening. This is my first time attending one of these events, and by the looks of it, I am a minority representing my demographic and age group in here, so. Wanted to speak to old business item number 4. We actually just moved in about 30 days ago, right off of Castleberry Road in Creekside subdivision. And just kind of found out about the information of it being widened and was kind of confused and taken back as to why. I actually bought a house several years ago on a main road and thought I would never do it again. So spent a lot of time sitting at the playground with my daughter and my wife. Just getting to look at it and make it feel because our house actually backs right up to the road. And I felt very confident that it just wasn't a high traffic area. So we went ahead and pulled the trigger. And after a month, we're really enjoying where we are. It's supposed to be our 15, 20 year home, brings a family kind of thing. And looking at the history of it, I guess this has been going on for quite some time. And studies were done and there was a ton of traffic. So forgive me if I'm ignorant and you know maybe things have just changed and that's why you're calling the vote to you know, do what you're doing. Traffic's not that way anymore and this is just going to go away. So I apologize, but just wanted to bring that you know to your attention. I just was very shocked to see that anybody was thinking about widening the road where there's just not a lot of traffic. And so thank you again.
Thank you, sir.
Our next speaker is Bradford, Jameson.
Evening. I want to speak on the subject of Castleberry Road. I read in the agenda that you handed out that action was taken on this on November 15, 2012, and I spoke at that time in opposition. I didn't realize that despite my comments you still passed it, I guess, because items under old business 4, 5, and 6 talk about a possible rescission of that plan to widen Castleberry Lane Road. And I'm opposed to it. I live in Kingswood on Castleberry, and I've been there for 3.5 years. And I just love the rural aspect of Castleberry Road, and in fact, all of Forsyth County, which I think is quickly getting paved over. And I'm distressed to see that, which is why I want to speak against the widening of that. I think now what I'm speaking to is the possible rescission of that expansion plan. And I guess one of the things that I'd like to know is why that decision has been made to make that into a 5-lane road, even if it has a beautiful median strip. It's still 4 lanes of traffic back and forth, which I don't think is necessary. And I wonder who does think it's necessary. Why was this decision made? What were the alternatives that were considered? Well, first of all, why was it made? Was it to get traffic from Route 400 up onto Route 20 heading west toward Canton? Is that the problem? Was it to try and avoid the awful traffic through Route 20 going past the courthouse out front here? Was that the reason? Was it for truck traffic to get that away from going past Route 20 in front of the courthouse? What were the reasons for this? What were the alternatives for that decision? Could there have been instead an expansion of Bethelview Road, which also leads from Route 400 to Route 20? And what were the costs? If that were an alternative, what were the cost comparisons between widening Bethelview or widening Castleberry? I probably said enough, but I just wonder, I don't know if it has a voice in this decision. I don't know why this decision was made. I don't know what the cost factors were. I don't know anything about a traffic study that might have been that would have made an alternative better. Thank you.
I would like to say one thing to you, sir. Bethelview Road is on schedule to be 4-lane from 9 to 20. It should be finished by 2017. So that is already on the plans and let the contracts out.
So what does rescission mean?
No, well, this is only on Castleberry Road. You asked about Bethelview Road. So Bethelview is on the board to be 4-lane, and it's underway.
That's a possibility.
It's there. It's going to be 4-lane.
So the plan right now is to widen both Castleberry and Bethelview?
Plan is to widen Bethelview right now, but the plan for Castleberry is on the sheet to vote on. But Bethelview is being widened and will be widened.
Well, I know it is from Route 9 up to Castleberry, but
it's going to be from there to Highway 20.
If that's the case, then I wonder all the more why Castleberry needs to be. Thank you very much.
Thanks, sir.
Our next speaker is Terry Irwin.
I'm here to talk about the application for Sobh Automotive. I live in the Wellstone community and I own property which is adjacent to the property that they're seeking a change in the zoning. I just wanted to comment that I have a career as a private manager broker, called a banker, residential brokerage. And as any homeowner, I'm concerned about the values that are affected by added commercial development next to my property. I'm here to say that I've got a record of the sales that have transacted since my Honda dealership came in next year. And those sales run from 238,000 at the beginning of the construction of Honda to a closed sale of 12/31/13, 282,000. The current price they're asking for properties in here now is 299,000. So I see that as a very positive thing that's happening. And it's because the Honda dealership has been a good partner to the community. We tend to know, or I suspect I know, what another dealership would do. My feeling is that it would have less impact on our community than another type of commercial development that the property is already zoned. So as one voice in West Point, I would look forward to solving that issue.
Thank you, sir.
Our next speaker is Dr. Joe Moses.
In office to the best skill of my knowledge and to the best interest of Forsyth County. I further swear I'm not the holder of any public funds or unaccounted for, so help me God. It doesn't say that you're to vote in the best interest of the city of Cohn. Quickly, I will to make it publicly clear that filing a conflict of interest action is easy. Any person may file a complaint alleging a violation of any of the provisions by submitting it to the clerk of court. The complaint must be supported by affidavits based on personal knowledge, set forth such facts, and so forth. A complaint must be filed within 6 months of the date of the alleged violation. That means that tonight, if someone feels that one of you may have had a conflict of interest, they can file a complaint for a conflict of interest up to 6 months from now. And I just want everybody in the office to understand that.
Thank you, Jeff.
Thank you.
Our next speaker is Bill Mulrooney.
Good evening. I know y'all pretty much know who I am, but for the record, I'm Bill Mulrooney, and I reside at 7510 Ben Creek Trail in Gainesville. I'm here tonight to talk about the Animal Shelter Committee. The last time I spoke at this podium was in regards to the county bite board, and that was at the request of one of you commissioners. In fact, many times in the past, board members have called on my expertise on animal welfare. There has been no controversy with the Animal Shelter Committee. The recent problems you commissioners dealt with were with the bite board, not the shelter committee. In fact, the shelter committee is probably one of the most civil groups in the county. The members discuss, debate, and make decisions with civility and respect. I cannot even recall a vote among them that was not unanimous. The shelter committee is made up of seven people. Currently, two of these seats are empty. It has been recommended by the chairman, Dr. Magruder, that Charles Meeker occupy one of those seats. Since the other committee members don't know Mr. Meeker, they have asked that he meet with them. The second empty seat is someone who is dedicated to someone from the animal welfare community. The committee had no such issues with me with recommending me for that seat, since I attend every meeting anyway. Whether or not the committee decides to recommend the seventh appointment is irrelevant. As Dr. Magruder pointed out in an open meeting, having an even number for this panel is not an issue considering the civility and dedication of everyone involved. And in case you're wondering whether I have the credentials to fill the animal welfare seat, I'll give you a little bit of my background. I'm a past member of the Forsyth County Humane Society, past board member of the Forsyth County Humane Society. I'm co-founder and current board member of the Humane League of Lake Lanier. I also sit on the board of ABC, a nonprofit responsible for over 75,000 spay-neuter surgeries for pets of low-income families. I work with the National Detective Dog Training Center in Newnan, Georgia. Thanks in part to my efforts, dogs that were once strays in Forsyth County now guard our nation's borders. In 2005, following Hurricane Katrina, my wife and I volunteered at the Emergency Animal Shelter in Hattiesburg, Mississippi. And in 2009, I completed American Humane Shelter Operations School. And I'm well-versed on the animal, on the county's animal control ordinances, as well as the state requirements for animal shelters. It is for these reasons that shelter committee members voted unanimously and wholeheartedly to ask you to seat me on their panel. I have also heard the concern about my application for shelter manager. I did apply for the position, and on October 16th of last year, I received a very nice rejection letter from the county. I don't really think this is an issue anyway, since the shelter committee is not part of the county hiring process. Regardless of all that, if by some chance the issue was raised during a meeting, I would simply recuse myself from the discussion. Please, don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. The folks sitting on a shelter committee have devoted 2 years of their lives to getting the job done right. Disbanding them with only a couple months left until the shelter opens can only be damaging and would go against the best interests of the county taxpayers. I believe that if you ever actually attend one of their meetings, you would understand what I mean. Please, allow the appointment to the Animal Shelter Committee to come before this board. It's just a simple up or down vote. It should not have all the controversy the board has attached to it. I would rather you vote no than to disband that commission. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Greg Raynor.
Thanks for taking the time to listen to me, gentlemen. I retired.
Sorry, just take your name and address, please.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes. Greg Raynor, 5110 Apple Grove, coming. I retired in 2010 to Georgia. I had been here to visit on several occasions, and it was the prettiest little town I ever saw in my life. I love it here. Had I known that and I look at Bethelview Road, there isn't a need to expand Bethelview Road. I mean, it's a major artery. Come off of 400, go the other way, there's no traffic problems. Coming this way, I see a need for it. The gentleman that spoke about buying a house and settling 30 days ago and playing with his kid in the backyard, I understand this, why I came here. Please don't do this. There's no need to expand that. There's no need to expand that. As a matter of fact, when I first got this letter from one of my neighbors, I swear I thought she was talking about Bethelview Road. I can't conceive anybody wanting to expand a road like Castleberry to a 5-lane highway. It just doesn't make any sense to me. My time is getting in front of my teeth. I can't see what I'm saying anymore, so I'm going to drop this now. You guys are going to get the address of a couple of good places to eat some cheesesteaks up in the hill to give you a call.
Thank you, sir.
Please don't do this.
Our next speaker is Robert Nydia.
Robert I used to live in the subdivision, Creekside here in Forsyth County. I'm here tonight because the issue of lighting Castleberry Road was addressed in November 2012. At that time, a motion was made not to revisit it until 2016, with the caveat of completing a traffic survey before reconsideration. That motion carried by a vote of 5-0. When the chairman was asked yesterday by a news reporter why this would be addressed tonight, the response was different commissioners. If you mean that the addition of Cindy Mills to this commission is the reason for that reconsideration, please state that. When asked why the road needs to be widened, safety was the response. We now understand from the check delivered by Mark Hamilton last week that economic development is the true focus. It is not traffic, as many of us were led to believe. I found some information sent in an email from John Kennard to Jeff Quisenberry on the subject of the Castleberry project, and I quote, "We had the 2005 and 2025 projections. I interpolated to get 2010, 2015, and 2020. As I told you earlier, if you try to justify this project based on projected traffic volumes alone being on the road when the project is complete, then you can't justify the project." End quote. If safety is offered as the justification, quoting a U.S. Department of Transportation article on road diets, more than 80% of pedestrians hit by vehicles traveling at 40 miles an hour or faster will die. In addressing the concept of a road diet, where residential roads with the 4 travel lanes are being reduced to 2 travel lanes in other areas with a turn lane, such as the proposal offered by Commissioner Levin, roadways have experienced a 29% reduction in all roadway crashes. Benefits include reduced vehicle speeds, improved mobility and access, reduced collisions and injuries, and improved livability and quality of life. Castleberry Road touches several residential neighborhoods and literally divides one, as well as providing the only entry and exit to a grammar school. Residents have been requesting lower speed limits on the existing road. No one will ever be more conscious of safety than the people who are touched by this road on a daily basis. Is there anyone here who believes that cars and 18-wheel trucks will go slower on a 4-lane road? Reducing the scope of this project is the best way to promote safety, and if economic development is the dominant reason, then I expect that you will ignore this plea. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Our next speaker is Patrick Gilligan.
I'm Patrick Gilligan. I'm a Forsyth County resident. I live at 4450 the River Court in Evans Farm. I am not any business before the court, but I am representing myself. I can't sum up what the last gentleman said any better than the way he summed it up. However, since the last vote was taken 5-0, why are we bringing this up again? Because you guys are going to have a 3-2 vote in favor of. I think it is wrong. When things get passed, they should be passed and upheld. However, the other problem is we have a congestion problem at the corner of Castleberry Road and Bethel Road. Part of it is being widened. However, until the rest of Bethel gets accomplished and finished, we're going to have another traffic jam there because you're dumping 2 lanes of traffic coming north to go through the intersection and have the orders come with 1 lane. If you build Castleberry out, you are going to compound that problem also, because you're going to have 2 more lanes of traffic going to that intersection. If they continue on through, they have to narrow down to 1 lane on Castleberry, or if they turn right, they're going to have to narrow down to 1 lane going north. In the invocation tonight, the invocation brings you all here
to do the will of the people. I suggest, since there is so much friction and discontent on this situation and on this road building, that to solve the problem, you put it out for a ballot vote and let the people tell you what they want. Thank you.
Thanks, sir.
Our next speaker is Charles Baumrucker.
Good evening. My name is Chuck Baumrucker. I live in Creekside Subdivision 6270 Sturbridge. I have been before you before in the same topic. I missed it because I didn't see it this coming, this short period of time. It came out of nowhere. Okay, I don't know why it is. Apparently there's some money involved from the state. We also know that most of the things have already been said. We do know that the Veterans Parkway runs parallel and it cuts a lot of that traffic off. I don't see what the need is to do the four lane or the six lane down there, and particularly it dead ends on a two lane highway, which needs is the Highway 9, right? That is the one that needs to be four lane. Okay. The only trucks that I see out on Castleberry are of course, a lot of buses. There's still very little traffic out there. I do want to mention, though, that there is a lot of work that needs to be done on Castleberry for these subdivisions, for the turning lanes, so that these people can get out. They put a stoplight on Bethlehem, which clogged the whole thing up, but and I'm not sure we need stoplights there, but they do need a lot more turning lanes so that the Wades and the whatever and the water in those areas can, in fact, get out. That does need to be done, okay? My point is that I thought maybe we could defer this thing for another month or so, because a lot of us who get involved in these things are into it only in the last 3 or 4 days or 5 days, because we didn't see it coming. So I guess it was our error on that point. So my point is, if you could shift your vote out a little bit so we can have some time to do some homework and get the public out and informed on this, we'd greatly appreciate it. My name is Chuck Baumrucker, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Jeff. Our next speaker is Douglas M. Thompson.
My name is Douglas Thompson. I live way back at 70. I'm a lifetime member of this camp. I'll start off this morning. I pulled up there to come out of Castleberry 5 minutes to late. I got home Castleberry 12 minutes after that. That is a freeway. It needs to be widened. If they don't widen, they need at least 7 red lights on it. Well, I've been in this county all my life. All these people just moved here. I know what that looks like. I've traveled every day. It's just like going back and forth to Atlanta. I've been on that way. Castleberry needs something done to it. Bad. Just go back 4 months ago. I tried to get out, the lady hit me in the wheel. I got the ticket for it. So the speed limit don't mean nothing. Because the speed limit was 40 miles an hour. The deputy wrote down 45. So what did I do? So I accept the ticket. But honestly, you commissioners need to do something. All of it. And I appreciate it.
Thanks, sir. Mr. Chairman, that was our 10th speaker.
I think we've got one more. Yeah.
Two more, sir.
Two more.
Yes, sir.
Without exception, y'all. I think that's fine. Okay.
Next speaker is Ethan Underwood.
Chair, members of the board, Ethan Underwood, Woods and Johnson firm. And speaking on behalf of Sobh Automotive, we just wanted to state publicly that since our last meeting, we have looked at two of the variances that we have requested on this portion of the property. We've asked for an extra hour of deliveries from morning and night, and also we can ask for a variance for additional display area along Nycz Road. We are withdrawing our request for the display variance on Nycz Road. We're comfortable with the board's number. Thank you.
Thank you.
Our next speaker is Lee Cohn.
Good
tonight. My name is Dean Cohn. I live at 6625 Stratford Place in Cumberland, Georgia. I'm here to speak on behalf of a project on Castleberry Road. It comes to quite a shock to the people in this room that you're planning to rescind your vote from 2012 and are reconsidering going back to now a five-lane road when you had previously agreed, as has been mentioned tonight, to a three-lane road with traffic lanes built in and safety improvements, which of course are needed. If you rescind your previous decision tonight and you vote to curb, in my opinion, more than 1,000 residents living near Castleberry Road, widening largely empty road, you had previously agreed to a traffic study. I think that traffic study was never made, essentially because you couldn't find any cars to count. If you rescind and you vote to widen, you can expect, I believe, continued opposition from the residents that live along there. Many were not aware, even though it's been part of Splash, the thing that you're going to widen the road. They're becoming aware now. There's all kinds of activity on the internet. There's press releases. There's been interviews on the by the press. I think they're interested in why the town would spend $12 million on an empty road. It doesn't seem to make sense. If economic improvement is a reason, then I guess the residents from Castleberry are going to expect 18-wheelers to go down that road instead of use Veterans Parkway, which would be far more efficient and save $12 million. I really urge you to continue to reconsider and not widen the road. If you do, I think the people are going to continue to be upset and exercise their displeasure with the courts. Thank you very much again for letting me speak, and I appreciate it.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Chairman, that was our final speaker.
Thanks, sir. On item six, the chair will entertain a motion to adopt the minutes of the regular meeting, the public hearings, and the executive session of February 6, 2014. So, motion second. Approved. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Chair will entertain a motion to adopt the minutes of the work session and the executive session of February 11, 2014.
Amen.
Motion second to approve. Please vote. Chair will entertain a motion to adopt the consent agenda.
Second.
Motion second to approve. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Item 7, old business. 1A, Mr. Brown.
Zoning application 3652 Home South Communities LLC, located in Commission District Number 3. The request is to rezone 36.88 acres from A1 to Res 4 for 96 residential lots with a density of 2.73 units per acre. Variance is requested to reduce the distance between structures to 11 feet. The property is located at 280 and 290 Mulnex Road, Alpharetta, Georgia 30040. Planning Commission recommends approval of this rezoning from A1 to Res 4 with a variance and conditions. The proposed variance and current conditions are shown on your screen. Public hearing was held on October 22nd, 2013. Thank you.
I didn't see any variances. Have they been removed?
They have been.
Yeah, they have been. It's not supposed to be there. And that's not a rest, three or four anymore.
Right, I'm just three. And so what is the density now?
I think it's 2.06.
2.1, I'm not, 2.16, I'm not sure what that is.
Well, the 75 lots is 2.4. It says 2.4.
And what's the 75 that just reduced to, what was that again?
2.03, what's it?
2.03 on 75 lots?
Yeah.
75 lots is the last condition, right?
Yeah, 25 square feet.
The variance has been removed?
Yes. Make sure, like Tom needs a variance, that all conditions.
What you called out, Tom, was what they originally submitted at the first, when they put in for zoning.
That's correct, that's what's on file with our office.
Right, but what we're seeing before us is what's been negotiated, where it started out as a res 4, it's now a res 3. Where it started out, they were asking for 96 lots, they dropped it to 75. And they were asking for variance before, they're asking for no variances now.
That's right, it looks like this is a version newer than the Planning Commission's product. Came out of the Planning Commission with 84 lots. I think you just mentioned this document on the screen at 75.
Yes.
So it looks like a newer version.
It's been an ongoing work in progress. I don't say in addition to this, but it's an ongoing work in progress.
Yeah.
That's continuing to walk down the density.
Commission District 3. You see an opposition, Commissioner? Come in.
I have. I'm going to start out with a motion of approval for the zoning as a res 3 on ZA 3652 with a minimum size lot of 14,500 feet and the rest of the conditions to stay as shown.
Are they still getting 75 houses?
No, they will not get 75 houses with that.
We have a motion. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? Please vote. Motion dies, 3-2.
All right, I'll try another motion. Like a motion to accept the conditions as shown with the following changes on ZA 3652 as a res 3, putting the lots in at a 13,500 square foot per lot. Rest of the issue stand.
Second.
You already have a density of two units an acre.
Yeah, I mean, they come out with
2.03 units an acre. I thought you agreed to these conditions. No, I didn't know. The last meeting we had, we were trying to get 14.5. They wouldn't come up at all off the 12 that's there. And I'm just trying to find something to come up a little bit here.
12 is a pretty good size lot for rest 3. I mean, it's a decent size lot, decent size.
And again, you're 2 units an acre.
Yeah. Well, we have a motion and a second. Any more discussion? Please vote. Motion dies, 3-2.
I'd like to make a motion that we approve the zoning ZA 3652 as presented.
With conditions as displayed?
Yes.
And no variances?
No variances.
And not any variances?
As a res 3.
As a res 3, as displayed, 75 lots. They're also something that hadn't been mentioned. We're asking, since we're four-laning Mullinax, they're giving up 1.72 acres in right-of-way.
Is that in there?
It's included. I mean, it's 30.
Is it on the list?
Number one speaks to...
Well, they started off with 36.88 acres, and after the right-of-way, they'll have 35.16 left.
Are you comfortable with that?
I don't see it's a condition jumping on you before we have a second.
We're trying to make sure the right of way.
Dedication of right of way for the construction of the widening of Mullinax Road.
Yes.
You've agreed to it, but is it in the conditions?
They're compliant with agreed to zoning of right
of way. Do you need some specific figures?
We just need to make sure that it is a condition that the right-of-way dedication for the Mullinax Road widening project is required.
And they're going to fund the turn lane at Mulrooney and Unit Hill.
Correct. That's him.
That's number one, but number one doesn't address the right of way.
I'd like to add that.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman.
Sir.
Change.
I'm sorry.
You would accept a change as Mr. Norwood has suggested.
All right.
Mr. Chairman.
Did you second?
Well, I'm going to ask you to withdraw your second, and just because we got into discussion before we got a second, could I respect for the sanity of our clerks? Could we ask for Commissioner Mills to restate the motion?
Restate this.
Okay, I make a motion that we approve the zoning for ZA 3652 with the conditions as presented, adding a condition that the developer will donate right of way as suggested by staff.
As required for the Mulrooney Road widening project.
Okay, as required for the Mulrooney widening project.
Second.
Motion and second for approval. Please vote. Motion carries 4-1. Okay. Item 2, Mr. Brown.
AZ 130032, located in Commission District Number 5. This is a public hearing on Automotive of Cumming Inc. regarding the amendment of zoning condition number 53 placed on ZA 3063. The applicant is also requesting variances to the Forsyth County Unified Development Code, Section 12-10.9, to allow 100% of the display of vehicles to be visible along road frontage of Highway 20 and Sanders Road, and Section 12-11.3 to allow truck deliveries at any time. The applicant requests that condition number 53 be amended to read as shown on your screen. The property is located on the east side of Sanders Road, north of the intersection with Buford Highway. It was zoned CPD by the Board of Commissioners on April 18th, 2005.
Thank you, Brown. Tom, I'm not sure we're talking about the same thing. You mentioned about visibility from Sanders Road. This is the piece that's over on Knuckles Road.
I like the conditions.
Mr. Commissioner, there actually was a typographical error in the original application, so I think that's why I made it.
Okay, but you're giving up that anyway.
We do not need the variance for this building.
And is that variance number 2?
Yes, sir.
Commissioner District 5, Commissioner Ball.
Yes, sir. Has everything scrolled through? Yes. I'd like to make a motion that we approve AZ 130032, ZA 3063, with the conditions as displayed. And variance number 1 only. Variance number 2 has been removed.
Second.
Yes, they did.
For discussion, did they add any to the 10 feet? Did they give any of the room back to the 10 feet off that back line? Nothing. Because they were considering doing it in one small portion, I want you to understand, not the whole area. They were absolutely told that they would consider doing one small portion. Can't do it. Andrew Wall.
Now we have a motion and a second. Any more discussion? Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Item 3 concerns a major road development. I've accused myself last time on this because I have some land that butts up to this piece of zone, so I've accused myself from any discussion and vote on this matter. Turn over to Vice Chairman Mr. Mills.
AC 140004, located in Commission District Number 3. This is a public hearing from Majors Road Developers LLC regarding the amendment of zoning condition number 68 placed on ZA 3411. The applicant requests that condition number 68 be amended to read as shown on your screen. The property is located on the north side of Atlanta Highway, approximately 1,000 feet southeast of the intersection of Castleberry Road. On the southeast side of Castleberry Road, approximately 585 feet from the intersection with Majors Road, and on the south side of Majors Road, approximately 800 feet from the intersection with Castleberry Road. It was zoned NPD by the Board of Commissioners on September 17, 2009. Thank you.
Yes, this is in District 3.
Thank you, Ms. Vice Chair. Let me finish scrolling. This is a change of conditions to come up with the streetscape. Apparently, their architects have been working hard on this, and they have full sheets to show
to give it a much better look at the neighborhood. And we've been working on this for probably 2 months now. Come up with something that makes a lot of sense.
Break up monotony.
Break up monotony, give it a new look that, it's definitely a new look that people are looking for. Thank you. I make a motion and we approve the zoning amendment 3411 that goes on to ZA140004 as displayed.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
Please vote on the motion. That is approved. Four to nothing with Commissioner Chairman Amos abstaining, recusing.
Item four is the board consideration of possible rescission of board's action taken on November 15, 2012 regarding Castleberry Road widening project. Do I hear a motion from the board?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I would move that the board rescind its action taken on November 15, 2012 regarding the Castleberry Road widening project.
Second.
Motion and second. Any discussion?
Please. If this passes, this removes the 5-0 vote for safer two-lane road that was approved in November 15, 2012. Correct?
Correct, Counselor.
That is correct.
The same one that required a traffic count and another study for change it four-lane to confirm it actually needed to be a four-lane. Is that correct?
Correct.
It would remove all of the components of the November 15th action to
traffic study that wasn't required. You just never requested it.
Thank you for clearing that up. You never
requested it.
Any other discussion? Please vote. Motion carries 3-2. Item 5, board consideration of an updated agreement for the Castleberry Road design. Is there a motion for the board?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I would move that the board enter into an updated agreement for the Castleberry Road design as presented, Council, in our books.
Commissioner, I think you're just providing direction to the engineering department.
Okay, then I would move that we provide direction to the engineering department for an updated agreement for the Castleberry Road design.
Second.
Motion second. Any discussion? Please vote. Motion carries 3-2. Item 6, board direction to the Department of Engineering to commence taking all necessary action to place Castleberry Road out to bid. Is that a motion from the board?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I would move that we direct the Department of Engineering to commence taking all necessary action to place Castleberry Road out to bid.
Second.
Motion second. Any discussion?
Yes. We just used up all the SPLOST 6 bids ago. SPLOST 7 money is now finishing up the jail courthouse with additional money that we agreed with engineering could have for the road topics and emergencies. Where in the world are you going to get money from to put this out to bid?
I think that's next to the agenda.
Just want to make it clear.
Yes, sir.
Spend.
Any other discussion? Please vote. Motion carries 3-2. Item 7, board consideration of any necessary resolution for Castleberry Road construction funding. Any motion from the board?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I would move that we direct staff to provide any necessary resolutions for the Castleberry Road construction funding.
Second.
Motion second. Any discussion?
Where's the funding? Where's it coming from?
Well, you know where it's coming from.
Hotel?
Where it will come from SPLOST eventually, but to kickstart the project, we have $1 million that was delivered 2 weeks ago by the Department of Transportation because they feel strongly that this is a worthwhile project.
Of course they do.
And then the rest of it comes from the sales tax dollars that the voters approved.
But none of that's available for 4 years. None of that will pour on the ultimate before the foreowners unless you do an additional bond, cost additional interest.
So we don't need a bond for Castleberry.
You're going to have to draw down money on the jail courthouse and slide it around into the table and make this happen.
I don't think so.
That's what we're going to talk about before I figure out what to pack. Any other discussion? Please vote. Motion carries 3-2. Item 9, new business. Request adoption of bond resolution.
Bring in Joe.
Good evening, Commissioners. My name is Horace Brown. I'm the Deputy Director of Emergency Management at the county. Before you tonight are two documents. One is declaring a local emergency, which starts the process when we decide there's an emergency. The second is to end that emergency, which is dated February 14th, 2014 at 4:30 p.m. I request that you approve these resolutions as they're presented.
Nobody has to listen to you anyhow. What do you know?
Yeah, what do I know?
Yeah, I'm talking 7-1 opposition should, to a proposal.
To what proposals? Yeah. That's exactly what I expected. I could have put some money down on that.
But don't you love how that tastes?
Recession, if you will, that these properties would develop these fines. This was one of the last properties that had a tremendous amount of fines on it. You may recall that in 2012, the Board of Commissioners did what I am calling a mass fine reduction program, where we basically took all of these significant accrued fines that were existing on all of these properties and reduced them based upon a formula. And the product of that formula was, it could be varying amounts of settlement, but in no event was the amount going to be greater than $50,000. All right, well, what we're proposing here with respect to State Bank, because these were the two issues they had, with the permit hold and the sewer, is we are proposing, first of all, a sewer agreement with State Bank. And the sewer agreement set forth in this sewer document, they would basically, the county would basically guarantee 30,000 gallons of sewer will be made available to this property or to a subsequent developer of this property at the existing prevailing rate, which is $21 a gallon. All right, so they're not getting any sort of a compromise or concession with respect to the sewer value. If during a two-year period the county goes up on its sewer rate in this basin, they would continue to derive the benefit of the $21 per gallon. Also, during that two-year period, and this was a concern that some of the commissioners had, if there is a demand for this 30,000 gallons of sewer that cannot be satisfied because of this locked-in amount, we have an obligation to place the developer on notice that there's been a demand for the sewer, and if they don't buy it now, however much they need at that time, it's gone. So really, Mr. Chairman, there's not a whole lot of concession going on here. It's simply providing the property some sort of an objective ability to have some sewer, but we are not giving up anything except a locked-in rate at our existing sewer rate in the basin. No, there's almost.
You should just take a breath, huh?
Yes, sir. There's also, with respect to the permit hold, what the county has proposed, and I believe what State Bank is prepared to accept, is that the county does not want to relinquish the entitlement to retrieve, or at least have as a potential for retrieving the fines against the entities that caused the fines. We would like to continue to have the right of recourse against that entity should that situation arise. However, with respect to making the property viable again, what we have worked out is that a developer, as part of the sewer payment, will also pay an additional $50,000 at the time they draw down their sewer. And upon receipt of that $50,000, we will agree to release the permit hold so at least that developer can continue to develop this commercial tract of property and will not hold them up upon the payment of that $50,000. The underlying fines with respect to the entities that caused the fines would continue to be on the books. Candidly, I doubt there would be an opportunity to recover them because they will probably not be developing anymore because they're not terribly viable economically at this time. But that would continue to be, we're not waiving those as applies to the individuals or entities that ran up the fines. There's some additional housekeeping items in this document, Mr. Chairman. One of those is an escrow disbursement. Some years ago, the entity that was doing the development had their permitting placed on hold because they had a sewer line that was built on private property, and the property owner was saying, you don't have an easement. Water and sewer held their permit, and in order to allow them to continue to move forward on the project, we required that they place $9,000 in an escrow agreement. At this point, we've been unable to confirm that they ever did the things that were necessary to allow the release of that $9,000. However, basically the underlying developer is defunct, as we understand it, or not economically viable. But we would recommend that you authorize me to release that $9,000 candidly to State Bank. That is the legitimate owner of that fund, so that money anyway, given that they have the security interest on the debt of the underlying entity. And that if those documents are in this settlement, this agreement, that would authorize the disbursement of the $9,000, again, not a significant amount. Finally, Mr. Chairman, this document contains mutual releases. There would be a release of all claims by Forsyth County against State Bank and a release by State Bank of all claims against Forsyth County. So it does a lot, but candidly, I think it's a win. To the extent that we're going to be able to avoid litigation. I'm not asking you to take action tonight. I just wanted to fill you in on the details. If you have any questions, you can ask me of them. And then Mr. Hamilton or another attorney from my office will be there on Tuesday to actually ask that you take action.
Okay, we'll take action on Tuesday, sir.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman.
That's what I wanted to know.
Mr. Chairman, I think I have two questions.
Yes, sir.
Counselor, have you or anybody that you know of in county staff in the last roughly year had any conversation with directly with Mr. Skrinner?
No.
Do you know whether the bank has or not, State Bank?
I don't know.
You don't know? No. Thank you.
Any other questions? Counsel, is there a need for an executive session?
Mr. Chairman, John.
I have a motion to adjourn the board of commissioners meeting.
So moved.
Second. Motion second. please vote. Motion carries 5-0. We extend adjournment 6:14.
Good morning, Senator White. Dinner's in the basement.